Thank you very much. Good evening and welcome. Our special guests tonight have been called the quintessential Beltway power couple and America's favorite odd couple, and between them, they have a lot of years of political experience. They are part Lucy and Ricky, part Grant and Lee, part elephant and donkey, and all red, white, and blue. Mary Matalin formerly served as assistant to President George Bush and consular to Vice President Dick Cheney, becoming the first White House official to hold both titles. Before joining the Bush-Cheney White House, Matalin hosted CNN's critically acclaimed debate show, Crossfire. She has held senior positions in George H.W. Bush's 1988 and 1992 campaigns and was appointed by President Bush Chief of Staff for the Republican National Committee and Chief of Staff for the Republican National Convention as well. At the Republican National Committee, she was a well-established political leader and actually ran the place for a period of time. And most recently, she worked for Fred Thompson and George Allen. James Carville is a Democratic strategist and former senior advisor to President Bill Clinton. He orchestrated Clinton's 1992 campaign and earned him the Campaign Manager of the Year Award by the American Association of Political Consultants. Since the Clinton victory, Carville has advised many foreign clients, including former Israeli Prime Minister Ehud Barak. He is an author and a talk show host, a restaurateur and an actor and a producer. Together, Matalin and Carville co-authored the best-selling book, All's Fair, Love, War, and Running for President. Taxes, healthcare, the economy, you name it, they both agree to disagree. What they do agree on is that they both love this country. Please welcome my very good friends, Mary Matalin and James Carville.
There's three ways to look at this for the final week. And each of those, I contend, hold that this race is not over. First, let's set the table. What is the zeitgeist? This is the worst environment for a Republican to run in forever. I can't even think of any Democrat that or a comparable situation where one party's brand, the Republican brand, is so low. We have a 90% wrong track. We're in a global economic calamitous situation. We're engaged in two wars, and the opposition is an historic candidacy. There's Barack Obama is an orator of operatic capacity, but as I say to James, not that he goes to the opera with me, but you go to the opera and you're weeping and you're crying and you love it and you're so moved and you get home and you say, what did he say? It was an Italian. I don't know what he said. So there is a capacity of that. So but he's a very skilled politician and he's raising a gugob of money. So that's the environment which John McCain finds himself running in. So that he is where he is in these polls is it's nothing short of astounding. Now, I know the polls took a very took a drift away, the press and others would like to say, and it's for psychological warfare purposes. The opposition will say, it's over, the race is over, stick a fork in it, he's done. When the polls started drifting away can be exactly specifically correlated and quantified to the beginning of this economic calamity that we find ourselves in, specifically the Lehman Brothers collapse and John McCain's subsequent first response to it. Subsequent to that, the combination of the debates, his getting his economic message right, fine-tuning it, Joe the plumber, the election getting close, we're getting into the choice. It's not just change, it's a choice. All of those things have combined to make this go back to a pretty steady, and it has been steady for 2 weeks, with it's about a five-point race. That is not an over. That's not over. In this environment, that is way not over. I know what the McCain numbers are. I know what the public polls are. And to the extent that the public polls could have such a wide swing from 14 points to a one-point poll, which IBD and Zogby or others have had, and they go back, that means something's not going right with the polls. So the campaigns have much better polls, much tighter turnout models against which they're overlaying them, and much tighter screens. And they have, the McCain people have about a 4 or 5 point race. More importantly, which is the top lines, which are always lagging indicators. Know this as you're looking at polls, they are lagging indicators, and the state polls are lagging indicators to the national polls.
The history that you are seeing, the history you're seeing, you go and you can go study all this history and all these professors and everything, you are seeing in terms of American presidential politics, you are seeing more history in this cycle maybe ever. Right here, right before your eyes, right when you're in college. This is stunning what has happened. You think, go back to the original field that was run for president this time. This original field contained the following: the first credible woman candidate for president, the first credible African-American, the first Hispanic candidate for president, the first Italian candidate for president. We've had people been married twice before. It's the first time we had somebody been married three times run for president, and the first credible Mormon. Think of all of that happening in one cycle. Don't kid yourself. When I was, history used to have a long arc. Things happened over a long period of time. Not anymore. One cycle blew the hinges off of everything. This is one of the things I really find interesting about this race. The original field for president contained three cancer survivors. This country is never going to go back to when the choice for president was an old white guy and a really old white guy. That's gone. And it all happened in one cycle. And that's a stunning thing that we saw. You're seeing records that are set like we can't imagine. Fundraising records, $160 million in a month. We'd spend that in a whole cycle. I can't go back and say in 1992 we did this. We did no such thing. Turnout, not up 5, 10%, up 50, 60, 70%. We were all positive that the political convention was a thing of the past. No one watched political conventions anymore. The most watched political convention in television history was this year's Republican National Convention. Stunning. Just think of the confluence of historical events that you're watching right here. Can you believe this? The last time that we had a presidential cycle that didn't have a sitting president or vice president run. You might say 1952, but that Barkley was actually running and he died in the middle of the campaign. You have to go back to 1928. In the Republican Party, the last time the Republicans have had a successful presidential candidate that didn't have a Nixon or a Bush on the ticket, 1928. I mean, just think of this, what stunning history that you've seen. In this thing that started back in 2007. And it's just to see this come to light and for you to be able to live through this and see this is a remarkable thing. So, yes, understand, study your history, learn your history, but understand you are living in historical times. You are living in real historical times. Future generations are going to come and going to study this time, study this election like you can't imagine.